because maybe we expect some visitors that don't speak my strange mix of Swedish and Norwegian. And anyway, might be someone looking at the video afterwards. I'm going to do like this. I'm going to talk a little bit, play a little bit, or play a clip on the video, and talk again, and play, and so on. So I hope it's going to be in a way that you won't fall asleep. And absolutely. First question.
Can we ask questions as you go along, or do you prefer us to wait till the end?
Absolutely.
We can ask as you go along.
Yes.
Okay.
Because the first thing I want to say is a question to you, actually. And it is, what is music? And you can think about that question and maybe come with some proposals while you look at the first little video clip. Which is the reason that I show things on video is because it's too much to carry all the instruments with me. So there are some instruments that I wanted to show you that it's too much. I don't have a carrier with me, for example. Yes. So that was the first instrument I made. It's called the butter bass because it's made from a butter box, I think. It looked like one. And the origin of this instrument is from a dream that I had once. But in the dream, I actually cheated a little bit when I made this one. Because in the dream, I'm standing on one leg and holding the instrument like this and playing like that. And one interesting thing that I think about this instrument is that it has only one string, and anyway, you can do so much different sounds with this one string. And also that I thought that I invented this instrument, but actually I didn't really, because there are some very similar instruments from the North India, Bengal, which are smaller, but exactly the same principle, a single string without a neck, just with the tension that you make yourself. Yes, and back to the question, what is music? Do you have any answers? Or any more questions?
Can I ask, is that what you're trying to find out? Is that what you kind? Is that your research? What is music? Because I find that is very interesting in the way of sound. And when does sound become music? And when does music stop being music and become sound? And it has to do with rhythm and it has to do with tune and all these things. But is that what you are trying to find out?
Sort of. I think it's always been one of the most interesting questions for me, since I make music, but it's to me, I ask the question, does it matter if it's music or not?
No, but that's not the question you asked.
No.
It is, what is music?
But it's
very interesting. It's very interesting if you really are supposed to push it, and you yourself think, does it matter? Because if you listen to like Sapa Yellow Shark and it's classical music, but it's not really music, it's kind of abstract, cartoonish work. and there's lots of other music or musicians who are working with sound.
Mm-hmm.
But I just think, what are you searching for?
First of all, sound. Sound in itself is just a physical phenomenon. It's something that happens in matter. It has to be matter, and it has to be movement in matter.
For it to be music.
For it to be sound. Just
to be sound.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
And the next question is, there's a lot of sound, like you said, that you don't perceive as music. And there are some sounds that you can discuss if it is music or not, and some you can have different opinions.
I think the question, what is music, is very similar to the question, what is art? And
yes.
the discussion can go on forever, what is music, what is not music. It's important, I think, whether you present it as music, whether the person thinks of him or herself as a musician, or an artist.
Is it important for you to make
not important to me at all to make something different.
But do you see, can you recognize music as art, as something different from music as popular culture?
I see what you mean. There are some people, at least there's one composer in Stockholm that has talked a lot about that he doesn't want his sound art to be music at all. He wants it to be electronic, electroacoustic art. That's the term he prefers. And in England there's a common concept, sonic art, which is different from music. Which in educational circuits, it makes a difference because sonic art is often teach not on musical high schools but on art schools or on universities very often, but not related to the musical scene. But I would like to return to the question actually, because I think music is something very specific, and it makes sense to think about what music is.
But don't you think it changes?
Also, when you think about music as art,
No, don't you think that changes? Our perception of what music is changes. And
yes.
And how this being more abstract from what our earlier perception of what was supposed to be music is changing.
Yeah.
And that is one of the things I think is very interesting with what we today called abstract music or sound, which could only be like a track of and today we perceive that as only being sound, but maybe in 100 years' time that will be our way of relaxing and listening to music.
Yeah.
So I don't think it is something that is like that is art or that is music.
Mm. I have an example which for myself may things put this question again, because I was living in a place where I heard some noise from the neighbor. I thought he was playing music late in the night, some boring melody with guitar and boring voice, and I went up to him to complain because I didn't want to listen to it. And he said, "Oh, is it so loud? I'm turning off my stereo then." And then I went back and I was still hearing this noise. And then walked around in the house, and it wasn't from the neighbor. It was the wind blowing in the staircase, making these strange sounds. So it wasn't. It was a sound that was never intended to be music, but I perceived it as music, even if I didn't like it. So, in other words, I mean, I think music is relation, human relation to sound in some way. It could be a physical relation, it could be a mental relation, or very intellectual, or purely sentimental or something. And it doesn't matter if you like it or not, but you can listen to any sound as music. But it's, I think it's a way of perceiving it. It's a mental state. So,
but what is
the questions that you were talking about, I'm going to return to them later. Again?
No, I just wondered, what is it that you're interested in then? Is it where the sound becomes music, or is it how kind of sound affects you?
I think I will probably answer that later. I had some other notes. Suggestion that we don't need to repeat. This is my suggestion of definition. Music is primarily non-symbolical ritual interaction between sound structures and human structures. And there's one more thing that I should mention here. Ritual. I think that word is quite important to me at least, because especially when you think about the concert situation, when you play for an audience, the thing that happens is not only that it's a musician making something for someone else. We're quite used to this way of thinking. In this society, at least. But I think it's, to me it's more important that it's something that you make together. Because if music is made when you relate your own structures to sound structure, then the audience makes the music also. And they make it quite actively, actually, because when they meet these structures, or it's not only the sound, actually, it's the same thing with art, all kinds of art, that you recognize something. You make yourself a little bit you sort of mirror a little bit what is happening in the situation. And by doing that, you can become something yourself. So you are transformed, if only for the period that is happening. But you're making something of yourself when you listen. And that, I think, is the ritual aspect of it. That it's a social situation that everyone is sharing. What happens afterwards it would be very different, because if you're an individual participating in this place, maybe you grow someone else and actually become someone else, because everyone belongs to many different circles. And this is one circle for this moment. And everyone is participating in making this.
But you say that you're not interested in the symbolic part of it, of the music, but you're using, are you interested in the visual part of the of your music?
Yes,
yes, because you're using these ordinary things, making music. That doesn't have anything to do with the symbolic things, it's just the
horrible thing. No, I think the symbolic is quite overrated. Of course, anything could be symbolic, anything could associate to anything else, but it's so much else that is happening. When you do something, when you are on stage, you actually are living, you're doing something of your life for the moment. And I think you should do something that you really want to do and want to inspire other people to do. Should be some kind of an example, actually, I think so. But I think we've talked.
Yeah, I don't think I understand what you're supposed to do.
We'll return to everything, I think. Something especially important?
No. I just don't think I understand at all what you were getting at. Any of you.
We'll keep talking about it all the time, I think. Yes. This is one of the first instruments I made also. Made of metal, so I call it a metal harp, simply. It could be played as some kind of wind instrument. But it's mainly meant to be played with a bow.
Do you have any musical training? Do you know? No. No.
I used to play the piano when I was small.
Yeah. No. No. It's more like because I think music is like mathematics. So it's very much like numbers and things like that. And do you know when you make your instruments? Do you have like you know that if you make one shape like this and that, it will work like this and that, or is it more like it looks nice and
This wasn't very mathematical plan.
No, but it looks nice.
Different sizes triangles.
And so when you make it, you have no idea of how it is gonna
work
in sound.
I have studied acoustics in different settings. And one thing that, I have been educated as a piano technician,
mm-hmm.
piano builder.
Yeah.
That's why I came to Norway, actually. I did it in Moss in 4 years. And it's mostly that, but it's also because I'm very interested in the physical acoustics, in the physical aspect of the instruments.
What do you mean physical?
The material, how things work. Also the mathematical planning of things, but,
yeah,
but this is not very mathematically planned. It's just that you can expect that from a big sheet, you can get lower sounds than from a small one.
Well, isn't that mathematical?
But it's also a lot of quite unpredictable overtones from this one also. From the same piece, it's not only the lowest one. So it's a lot of different sounds from the same thing. And these kind of instruments that have the possibility of creating so many different kinds of sounds from the same thing interest me quite a bit.
Yeah.
Is that what really interested in the symbolic value of music or your music, but the instruments seem like to symbolize something when you play on them on stage. What do you think about that?
No, I'm not very interested in symbolism actually at all. I would say that I'm more interested in the poetical aspect of playing, the visual poetical aspect. Like for example, I'm using lots of found objects. I collect the objects that I like, if I find them on the street or anything. It's the some things that I collect just because I like them, and it takes a long time before they can make any sound at all.
More like personal choices when you pick materials.
Yeah.
It's not like when you made a flute, for instance, like you want like the crudeness of the metal and the lightness of the flute. Or is that in your mind also when you make it?
Well, every instrument has its own history, actually. Like, for example, those who were at the opening, maybe all of you, heard the finger violin. That was an acoustic idea of expanding the same idea with this single string instrument, to have it without a neck and to make it tension yourself while you're playing. So that was an acoustic idea. And I made it in a violin shape just in the last minute. I was just going to make a plank or something. But I just thought it was going to look better. So that's not an acoustic idea, that's purely visual. So it's a mixture between objects I like, I put together, and acoustic ideas. Some question over there?
How important is it to you that the visual aspect of the music? Do you really have to see what you're playing on, or is it possible to just listen to your music and get the whole idea?
I think it's both.
Mm.
I make recordings a lot. In one way, I prefer to perform, to be together with people. But I also like to record. But it's two quite different things. Also, if you only take the sound aspect, it's quite different. Because sounds that you make live, they don't work in the same way if you record it.
And what about
to me it's an attractive idea to be able to make instruments and sounds of found objects. You don't have to pay anything for it.
So the visible part of the music is plays that importance.
Yes. First, when I started to play the saw, which is quite a visual instrument, and first I was very irritated with people. Oh, look, he's playing on the saw. Is it the real saw? And making jokes and things. So I was disgusted with it for a while, but then I returned to it, and now I think it's I just get used to it. You can use the visual side also. Not, there's no reason to be against it for me. Like mine.
Some questions are already asked, but for me it's very much about sculpture. But he asked already about this visual aspect. But I'm also interested, is the music you get out of the instrument, is it kind of repetitive or repeatable? Or is it all the time you use this instrument, something else comes out of it? Or do you, I'm one into the direction of melody, or music is very much but also about rotation of repetition and things like this. So do you when you start playing the saw, is there this song of the saw and that song of the saw you can play? Or are you just improvising and it goes with your feelings for the day?
Mm. Most of it is improvising. But improvising is also using your experience a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So the more I play an instrument, the more I know what I can do with it, and the more I use my experience. And sometimes I think that I'm repeating myself too much, or making a too stable pattern of an instrument. And I want to be able to be surprised myself also. I don't want to be bored by playing my own music. So I like to make it new every time.
But you make your own instruments and compared to modern technique where you are able to make any sound you want just by parameters. You choose to make sound through sort of machine technique. You are quite conservative when you choose to actually make that kind of instrument. But of course, then you again you are concerned about the performing, because to make the sound you do it's very nostalgic, I think. you are concerned about making instruments, you're concerned about the basic of how sound is, the material sound, just as a singer is concerned about your voice.
That's only one thing. I'm very interested in acoustics, in the physics, but at the same time I use inspiration from chance and the chaos very much. If I find something, an object, I'm interested in what can I do with it. And it's the chance inspiration.
If you find another, do you hear how it
works down? Yeah, sometimes I can. But sometimes also it takes a long time before the object has told me what it wants, what kind of sound it wants to make, or not.
But what is it that you're looking for? that is really what interests me. What are, what is it that you're trying to find out? Because you've got two things. You have the instruments, the kind of sculptural part of it, and then you have the sound part of it, of that they make different strange tunes and things. I just wonder, what is it that you, what are you doing? I mean, no, but you're this person, which you find things and you invent these beautiful instruments, these things that make sounds, which are really nice and beautiful. But what is that you're really trying to find out? Or are you just making things? Are you just this kind of pet smart inventing things, you know? Things just falling down and you picking up the pieces, which is, it's okay, but what is like, the first question you had is what is music?
Mm.
And that's kind of like, you're looking for something, you're trying to find out something.
Yes.
But when you make these sculptures, and or when you're playing these sculptures,
mm.
what is it that you're really looking for? What is it, or is it anything at all?
I'm not looking for something specific. It's to me, it's a way of living in the sense. Way of enjoying yourself.
I don't understand that.
Enjoyment.
Yeah, but is it like you just accidentally, just find things,
yeah,
and then
yeah,
you try and make them into things that can make
accidents and chance and chaos, they're not important in themselves. But they're important as inspirations. They could be inspirations. It depends on what you do with it. If you're inspired by the thing, then it's a poetical moment. But if you're not inspired, it doesn't matter at all. So for example, there's a lot of composers from the 50s and 60s that have begun using chants in a deliberate way of composing music, which is, to me, very strange, because just chance in itself has no value at all. It's when chance strikes you in a very, very strong way, then it becomes valuable.
But what's your goal? What's your goal with all these?
I don't have any goal. Just to die.
So there's nothing at all.
No, I have nothing to do. There's nothing to do at all.
That's okay.
What do you think? You might be inhibited yourself, huh?
Inhibited by?
Have you kind of a fan that people inhibit you from making podcasts and music?
I use plans, like my plan for this sort of lecture, which has broken down completely. plans can be good. It can also be inspiring to have plans if you break them. But it's a kind of security to have a plan when you're going to perform. But I don't want the plan to be a dictatorship. Then it's no use to have it.
You mean more like a goal or something? You got a goal?
What's your point?
My goal when I'm performing, for instance, I want to try to be as passionate as possible. Then I hope it's greater possibilities to inspire others.
The book with the improvising, does that have something to do with to make personal music and professional music? Is that the only way to make professional music and only personal music?
It's not the only way. But I think it's a very efficient way. But with all kinds of methods, it it's no way of being having found the solution. There's no final solution. I actually thought for myself that pre-improvisation was a kind of solution, and everything else was just rubbish. But I don't think that anymore. For as a fact, improvisation can also create rubbish. And even if you're completely free, also the word freedom is very interesting, what it means and what people think that freedom is. If you are free, if you feel free, and are performing or making art or making anything for anyone else, it doesn't matter if you're free. You create freedom. You don't have freedom. You are not free. From the beginning, you're never free. You have to always fight to be free. So improvisation is not free in itself. It might be a fight for freedom. And freedom in itself is also like chaos or chance. It's not interesting in itself. It's interesting only if it's inspiring, if it's passionate, and if it's a correspondence between desire and reality.
Then I want to go back to what I asked for the first time. It's the most obvious thing when I poem is this whole like symbolizing brutality and making beautiful sounds, and also the violin, the divided violin making like opposite sounds of what you expect from the violin, and that is the first thing I think about. So when I don't understand when you say you're not interested in the symbol part of it, like how are you going to express that? This is you're talking about something quite different. You're not interested in that part of it at all.
Yeah, I just said it was overrated.
Okay.
Yeah, I didn't say that it doesn't exist, because it does. But I'm not interested in making symbolic music.
No, not symbolic music, but you're using things very
or symbolic
strongly,
performances.
Symbolic, like the story is quite symbolic being used.
Mm.
But that is not the main point for you.
Mm. But
the fact that
I like
you're making
your idea.
Your own instrument must mean something. The fact that you're not just doing experiments on ordinary instruments or ordinary equipment.
Mm.
You're actually making your own things. That must mean something, or that must have some kind of purpose behind
yes,
it. It must be why.
Mm. Yes,
why do
so.
You make your own instruments? Why don't you just experiment on ordinary violins or cello or clarinets or whatever it is?
Yeah, because I think these instruments are made for other kinds of purposes.
What purpose?
For the music that was made during the time that they were invented.
Mm, I don't understand that.
So you can use them. There are also very good musicians that use them in other ways. But that's a bit of a paradox, because maybe it's their own personal history. If you play the saxophone and you learn how to play the saxophone, and then you find out that you want to make your own music very, very different from the tradition of the saxophone.
Yeah, but you can do that
and
with the saxophone, can't you?
Yes, you can do lots of interesting things with saxophone that are outside of the saxophone tradition. But then you have to fight against the instrument, I think. Because other kinds of instruments would be actually much better to make these kind of sounds that these people do.
But it's very different to work with sound than to work with an instrument. It's like working with vocal. There's a very different things, you know, when you work with the sound you actually got or the instrument you have, and you can stretch it as far as you can. Mm-hmm. And you try and find out new ways of doing things with a saxophone over the vocal. It's very different to do that and to actually get a new instrument and to try and see what you can do. And so to work with an instrument and to experiment with an instrument and to work with a conceptual side of it as a sound is two very different things. I don't know what my point was, but...
I think it is interesting in that the sound is more important to you than the music. Is that you invent your own technique for making sounds that is similar to other sounds you hear like every day, but you put into another space. Is that your goal?
No, not really. I think to me, when sound are perceived as music, they become interesting to me. But in one way, I'm interested also in those kinds of music that defy all kinds of normal musical patterns. Because then you can, the chances are bigger that you can be surprised. That's no guarantee, of course, but it's more interesting too. So to me, it's more interesting to use natural sounds, or very raw sounds from objects, than to use sounds from musical instruments. It doesn't mean that I'm against normal musical instruments, not at all. It's just where my only interest. But I think we should play a little bit more because we've been talking too much. So that means that another video clip. That is called the Veloncell Marcel, and maybe some of you know why. Because it's a kind of copy of Marcel Duchamp's bicycle wheel on a stool, but a little bit different since it's made into an instrument. So it's a homage to Marcel Duchamp. And
what do you mean by damping?
Damping is the opposite. Of resonance. Resonance means it makes a frequency stronger.
Mm-hmm.
It swings in the same frequency. and damping makes this certain frequency to die sooner.
Mm-hmm.
It absorbs the energy.
Yeah.
And so it's just a physical idea that I like to do this parallel between the physical reality and the human reality. Like there are some things that are in a human character has also resonance and damping, and maybe resonance is not only the interesting thing, but damping is also quite interesting. When a person resists what happens around, it makes more interesting things to happen, maybe. And it relates a bit to my instruments too, because I have very little of resonance and more of damping. And that's why I have to... that's one of the reasons that I'm using contact microphones, because you don't have to make a resonance box for the instruments if you have a contact mic. You can have a very, very small instrument and make lots of big sounds from things that you don't hear if you don't put directly to the ear. And if we have some time left afterwards, I can show you how the contact mics work. Some of you might be interested to make this, because it's, if you know how to do it, it's very, very cheap. So don't go to the shop and buy a contact mic. It's too expensive and it's not as good. So another thing that we have talked a little bit about, the piece of art, object and the process, composition and improvisation. We've been talking a little bit about this. It relates to this discussion about what art is and where is art happening actually. Is it happening when you make the piece of art, or is it the result only that is art? And we talked about it's the ritual situation where everyone contributes to make this into art, and it's a specific way of being when you are in the art mood, so to speak.
Isn't it about what you are trying to say? What you are trying to tell us, in a way.
You mean as an artist?
Yeah, as an artist or a musician. Well, I mean, if you make pop music, you're trying to make us feel good or happy or entertained. Or if you're making like a deep art, you're trying to make us think of something.
Yeah. Yeah, I think the audience is reflecting a lot of what the artist makes.
Well, to me, it is all about what you are trying to say, because, as I said, you make your own artists, instruments, and that in itself says something in a way, but then you talk a lot about sound and what sound is, and all I'm sitting here wondering about is what are you actually trying to do, what is your, what are you trying to tell me? Is it something to do with art and sound, and when sound becomes music, or is it something to do with the instrument and music within music's own little bubble of what music are supposed to be, an instrument.
Mm. Yeah, I'm hoping to come out of that bubble with only music, because just music is not very interesting to me.
It's a different thing, yeah.
Yeah, or just art, for that matter. It becomes interesting when you enter the world as a way of being, as a way of living. I think
to be that I have to interrupt you. I have to talk to Kathy. Isn't it, where can you put the finger on somebody's work and say, this is what you want to tell me? Isn't it then already going? I mean, isn't it the nice thing with art that this has?
You don't know that you exist, yeah.
You know, that there is not this or that, or that there is not one sentence how we can kind of contain his ideas. And this is the strength of the work and not the thing, the weakness.
Oh, but that does not stop you from wondering what it is. You can see the pleasure of wondering, and thinking, oh, what is it that he's trying to say? But it doesn't, at least for me, does not stop me from really thinking, what is what you're getting at? What is your point? What are you trying to tell me? And even though the beauty might be the fact that I will never understand it, but I still will never stop wondering.
Mm.
I mean, because as I see it, as I said earlier, there are two things. And one thing is that you're making your own instruments, making your own kind of sculpture. And the other thing is you doing experiments on what is sound and what can sound be. And when you were playing on the wheel, it's like a statement in a way of sound can be whatever, or music can, it is everywhere, you know. But that's like me sleeping in my bedroom and I'm having the windows open and I wake up and I can hear these workers outside, and there's, you know, there's this sound, you know. And is it music, or is it sound, or is it just how I perceive it? Is it just relating or depending on my mood?
Mm.
I wake up and I'm happy and I can hear the rhythm in it.
It's two things at the same time, I think, because when I'm playing on an instrument that I made myself and improvising, I'm not sure, I haven't decided.
Stop.
You're talking too much. You haven't decided exactly where you're going to go, but you want to be there and explore what is going to happen when you start going in this direction. And that's the parallel thing to this, is that I like doing this, and that's a conscious choice, that you want to live without having decided everything where you want to go.
I know, but what
and
do you do when the tune shows up?
I'm not finished. The just plain thing, is that something miraculous, beautiful, fantastic might happen here. That's the essence, and that's enough. And the other thing is that the thinking part of it is I'm showing other people that I am deliberately being here and going out in this non-known direction, and I'm doing this in front of you, together with you, and it's possible for you to also do it. But it's this message, it's not the reason that I play. It's not the only reason that I play. I like this message, but I could also just tell you that. But it's more beautiful to play. And it's more enjoyable for me.
But so really, what you're trying to do is just encourage us to do this.
Yeah, or something else. You might be inspired to do something completely different.
Mm-hmm.
I can absolutely play. I like talking also, but I'm going to play a very small instrument called the Brillolin. you.
Excuse me, did you know what notes to play?
No.
No? It's kind of like a demonstration.
Demonstration?
What the instrument can do.
Yes, it was using all the possibilities. Ah, most of them. Yes, we've almost talked about all this. Free music equals free life. Art is utopia. Individualism or responsibility. So it's just to repeat what I was talking about before, in other words maybe. When you play music, you represent life at the same time as you are living on stage. You are doing something with your own life. You're using this freedom that the stage or art form can provide, and you're using it to make some kind of statement, or you make a statement in the way that you choose what you like to do. And then it's up to you what kind of world you are creating in this situation, inside these limitations. Are you making something that is involving freedom at all, or is it just repeating this notion of I am delivering a message to you, which is what we're quite used to, like making some kind of TV show, or are you what I hope to do, making something of your freedom that is involving inspiring others to take their own freedom as well. So you're repeating your own prejudice about being an amateur or being a professional or being superior to others when you do this. I don't think I have to talk more about that. Maybe I play an instrument that I didn't. Made by Robert Moog, an American. Thank you. playing, so I've broken this instrument as well. Or instrument or not, it's just some cheap toy instrument that I put together, and they're sort of breaking down gradually, but we are using many of them at the same time. So maybe I'll tell you what I actually did. I was using two very small radios, and I put them into the inputs. So they modulated the sound of the analog synthesizer, and also the voice was going partly into the distortion box and then into the Moog. So now you know how to do this. So are there any more things left? I didn't talk about surrealism actually. I was going to bring in that question because it's about what we're talking all the time. It started for me as a dilemma about 15 years ago. I was very interested in politics and interested in doing music at the same time. And I saw that dilemma. For me, it was a dilemma, first of all, because I didn't want to make music that was political. It was absurd and disgusting idea, I thought. And at the same time, musical politics. I don't know. Anyway, I didn't make these two interests to come together in the same kind of idea. That was a sort of intellectual crisis for me. And at the same time, I discovered surrealism through some friends. And during the time we formed the surrealist group in Stockholm, that still exists, and I'm still active in it. Surrealism is, first of all, not an art movement, as most art books say. It's not a style of art, it's not a style of poetry, and not a style of music. And it's not even known that musicians have been in the Surrealist movement. But there are some musicians active in the Surrealist movement. And it always have been, but none have been any famous. So that's why music is not known in the musical history books as having a surrealist possibility. It doesn't really matter because surrealism is not an art movement. It's two things. It's a movement of thought, of you might call it ideology or an attitude, and it's also a mental state. And this mental state in the surrealism, also in the surrealist tradition, there are very different words for this state or this way of thinking. And one is the concept of Automatism. Automatism is very close to improvisation in the way that they were exploring it in the beginning, in the 20s. It was mainly during writing something without any conscious control of what you're writing, just writing as fast as possible anything that comes into your head. As soon as it comes in, it goes out. So it's a bit like mediums work. And actually, the term automatism is stolen from Spiritism. And for the Spiritists, it was a way of making spirits or creatures from other planets or maybe dead people, anything that's not present, to come out with their messages, either in writing or also in designing, technique. So, but the Surrealists are using the term without any religious connotations, without any thinking of that it's someone else that is making it. Instead, they were in the beginning using terms from psychoanalysis, for example, like the unconscious. That, like, it's things that are in the unconscious that you let out if you just take away the conscious normal ways of stopping yourself. But automatism was stressed very much in the beginning of this movement, but it's not the only surrealist state. Also lots of other different concepts that are related to this. For example, objective chance is a less known concept. Objective chance is these kind of events that happen in reality, which seem to be like messages or very, very, very striking coincidences in your own life that cannot really be explained in a logical way. It's coincidences that are important to your subjective thinking. So that's one thing that is connected to this. And the connection point is that in some way, one way or another, reality and desire are united, or that you don't feel the contradiction between these two, between your subjectivity and the real world, for instance. Well, for myself, when I discovered Surrealism, of course I discovered this concept of automatism, and that seemed to me to be an answer to me, what I should do in music. So I started to interpreting this as being pre-improvised music, which I'm not the first to do that interpretation, there has been lots of others. Or there are some surrealists that have interpreted the concept of automatism to jazz improvisers, for example, which was much more common before the pre-improvised music appeared. Question?
What's the definition of surrealism?
Well, the first definition was actually automatism.
Which means
a sort of improvised state that is not controlled by consciousness in any way. But
so surrealism is.
But that's old. Surrealism has always been redefining itself. So it has lots of different concepts, which means that there's no simple definition of what surrealism is.
But is it not? I'm only asking because I don't understand. But is it like something that you cannot understand or don't know how to comprehend?
No.
No, what is it? I'm asking because I do not know.
Yes, but it's the question. The reason you ask this question is probably because the term surrealism is used for anything strange,
realism.
Especially in the English language.
Yeah, it is.
That's
something that is
really surreal if something is strange.
It's something that you cannot comprehend. It is something which is really, surreal. I do not understand the term.
But maybe you can actually drop the term surrealism
I'm asking because I want to know.
And is that using the word poetry for me?
Mm-hmm.
Because, you want to pause or what?
So I think I'm soon finished. Maybe it's not too much.
If you want, we can take a break and come back. Or shall I just go on? Okay. Just tell me if it's too long.
You can be a bit more.
No, I think it's interesting.
Because it's too stretched out.
Too much. Because some of the questions we can continue maybe afterwards, more informal. That was the question. Yes. I didn't answer this question actually. I didn't even say it. Is automatism and improvisation the same thing? No, it's not.
I'm sorry, what is autonomism? I've never heard it before.
Automatism.
Automatism of automatic writing.
Yeah. Not like someone from outer space coming into your body.
Yeah, for instance.
No, but it's that I've never heard it, so I'm not being funny. It's just I've never.
Automatic writing is also psychological thing, which you do in therapy. It's such an old term. Of course you know what it is.
It's not good, isn't it?
About school,
creativity without conscious control.
Okay.
And but improvisation is not the same thing. And it took some time before I realized it. Because improvisation is practice that exists in lots of different activities, and sometimes it's very, very controlled, actually. You improvise, but you know exactly what to do in this context. And that counts actually also for pre-improvisation, because there's so many clichés and habits and maybe experiences that you use quite consciously. So automatism can happen in improvisation, but it doesn't have to happen. And some musicians actually want to avoid it happen. Because maybe more if you're from the classical tradition, because for some musicians it's very important to be able to have control and know exactly what you're doing. And then they can repeat themselves also. They know exactly what you did. But it's not important for me to repeat myself too much.
So I think like when musicians are improvising, I don't know where it comes into the equation, but then they very often just draw the thing of what's happening around them. So when they improvise, they just take out exactly what's happening. If they're having a concert and they improvise, they just take the mood out of the crowd. I don't know what the point
maybe
is.
Maybe you should explain a bit about the tradition of pre-improvisation.
The tradition?
The pre-improvisation can be conceived as a genre different than any other musical genre. So it's not the way pre-improvisation exists today. Just
like jazz, rock, theater, pre-improvisation, and you have musicians working only with pre-improvisation, and it becomes like any other job. Yeah. But pre-improvisers have different opinions about that, actually. I think mostly today they realize that it is its own kind of music, but it's also dividing into different kinds of music. But more before, it was a discussion because some musicians wanted to make it a very ideological kind of music, that it had strongly to do with the term freedom. Maybe that's why it's using free young musicians, it doesn't matter as much, and some are aggressively against any political connotation at all. I'm not, but it's just to say that it's discussed. There's no agreed ideology in this kind of music. This is to mention another an American surrealist. He's called Hal Randall. He lived in Chicago, and I met him in 1987. And this meeting for me was important. He played the saw, for example, and we played the saw together, a saw duo. Saw is always best with as many saws as possible. And he's also inventing instruments, making fantastic, beautiful instruments since a long time. So if I hadn't met him, I wouldn't have been doing this, actually.